The First Crush. It was 1996 and I was in the 8th standard. Girls weren't pulling down socks to flaunt their legs yet. Guys were still to discover the wonders of hair gels. And girls were still not their top priority. We were all busy sprinkling ink on each other's shirts and sharing lunches. The happy pre-puberty days. And that's exactly when I met her. I saw the face, which imprinted itself on my brain for many years to come. Well, to be true, I didn't meet her, not exactly. I saw her across the room, full of rowdy and shouting 8th standard students. "Nisha?" the teacher had called out. "Yes, ma'am," she had responded in her chirpy voice. "How did she look?" "She was like the first breeze of autumn, like the sparkling sun after a long cold night. She was a midsummer night's dream. She barely came up to my shoulders. Her eyes were darker than the blackest night. Her soft pink lips seemed to be made out of candy. Her cute steps across the floor as she walked around would make my day. I still remember her perfectly well in our school uniform with a pink muffler around her neck and the reddish winter glow on her cheeks. Ah, how did I look? I was fat, dark, and ridiculously ugly. Like, totally ugly. It was as if God had something against me. If he had to make me so ugly, he should have played with my mind too and made me have a crush on someone as ugly as I was. Someone with freckles and unruly hair, maybe a lazy eye. Why her? Why Nisha? Why the cutest, chirpiest girl in the class? Anyway, 7 years later in the winter of 2003, I had just turned 18. It was my last year in school and somehow I had managed to grow even fatter and uglier. And she had only grown prettier. She was no longer the girl I had first seen 7 years back. She had grown positively womanly, if you know what I mean. She was cute then, but she was irresistibly beautiful now. Her lips had grown pinkier, her eyes were wider, and they sparkled even more now. Her hair was now long and worn in a style far beyond her age. All these years, the gap between her social standing and popularity and mine had just kept widening. Although I had grown taller and she was still short and hopped around like a pocket-sized bunny, it didn't make her any less ungettable. It was the last year and I was in the SA dilemma. What is a screwed anyway dilemma? It's something that almost every guy has faced in his lifetime. It's almost as common as the asshole boyfriend phenomenon. What is the asshole boyfriend phenomenon? It's when every girl you like eventually ends up going out with the guy you hate. Simple, right? Now, back to the screwed anyway dilemma. The girl is out of your league, but she is single. You ask her out, she refuses. You are screwed. The girl is out of your league, and she is single. Someone else asks her out. You are screwed. Now, the good news about the first one is that you don't feel choked about your feelings and you don't regret that you didn't tell the person you love about how you felt about them. And I just had to tell her. Never give in to this feeling. Nothing comes out of telling the person you love that you love him or her. It's bullshit. It's an urban legend. After doing it, you realize it's better to live on the tiny hope that maybe she loved you, rather than being rejected and humiliated outright. But I was just an ugly fat kid. What did I know about these complexities? All I knew was that she was the girl of my dreams, and I liked her to bits. Let's just rewind a bit to tell you what happened in the last 7 years of my secret relationship with Nisha. A relationship about which Nisha herself knew nothing about. I loved her like crazy. Within the first week of seeing her, I knew her phone number, the street she lived on, what her parents did, what bus route she took, almost everything there was to be known about her. Though getting all this information seems regular right now, the year was 1996 and things were different back then. As time went by, my obsession escalated. After a year, and for the next 7 years, I walked 2 kilometers every day after school so that I could share the same bus route. For the next 7 years, I always took 2 school bags so that I could take a seat in 2 rows and decide later which row would give me a clearer view of her after she took her seat. I did these things on a very regular basis. And now that I think of it, I guess I should have gone to a doctor instead. Anyway, back then, I wasn't a big extrovert. But by the time 2003 came along, I had retreated so far into my shell that I had problems even engaging in everyday conversations with people. Why did this happen? My obsession, now at dizzy levels, made me believe that Nisha would hear every word I say, and that I needed to measure my words before saying them out loud. And that is when, deep down, I knew for certain that a girl like her, who hung around with cooler kids with gel in their hair and motorcycles parked outside the school, wouldn't even give a passing thought to someone like me. She had a whole army of better boys who catered to her every whim and fancy. She was a pampered kid. Had it been left to me, I would have carried her around in my school bag to prevent her from the torture of walking. Man, I did need to go to a psychiatrist back then. But it was around that time that I realized that I was getting a little overboard, that it was just a crush and I had to get over it, especially since my grades had started to slip to unacceptable levels. I started to concentrate a little more on my engineering entrance examinations, putting everything else aside for a little while. It did soften my preoccupation with her. Sometimes I thought it would have been a lot easier for me had she started going out with somebody. But that's just pure speculation. I might have just killed myself, metaphorically speaking. I clearly remember it. It was the last day of our school when I mustered up the courage to go to her, my heart in my mouth, readying myself up for rejection. It was mostly out of panic because I felt I would never see her again. Who knew Facebook would burst into the scene in 3 years and you would always be in touch with friends you never wished you had? Anyway, she was almost set to go to some college in Delhi University, surrounded by boys and girls as cute as she was, and I was keeping my fingers crossed for my entrance examinations. I just had to tell her. I couldn't have chosen a worse time, though. It was only later that it came to my knowledge that there were 3 more guys, all of whom were better than I was, because being worse than me was kind of impossible, who had asked her out around those very days. All of them were turned down. Hi, I said. She smiled, as she always did, and said, "Hi, Joy." She fucking knows my name. Obviously she does, you asshole. You have shared the same class since you didn't even know what an erection was. "Hi," I said, and shut up. I started rubbing my palms together, which was sweating by now. I shivered. This was the best moment in our 7-year-long secret relationship. We had finally said hi. Our first real conversation. "Yes?" she said, still smiling. Nothing. I just wanted to tell you that I think you are very nice," I said. My face flushed red and my head spun. Yes, in those days, nice and cute were the only words we all used. Asking a girl out was a really big deal, and it took only a stud or a man crazed with love to do it. Having a girlfriend was unheard of, like a myth, something that only happened in movies or in colleges. Well, thank you, she said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.